Firstly, good afternoon, everybody. It's World Pay is not to be confused with well paid. I just want to sort of state that now. Thank you for these guys actually for having me here today. It's actually sort of, we get involved in a lot of these sort of niche events, but this one is of particular interest. I have to admit as well that I'm not a crowdfunding expert. And so what am I doing here? This is a very good question. Actually, there's some very key trends, I think, in the crowdfunding industry, which at least I've heard this morning and this afternoon as well. And those trends, first and foremost, I think that the industry as a whole is growing tremendously quickly. And what I understand is that it's driven significantly by the sort of millennial generation, which are a bit more willing to spend online and perhaps a little bit more mobile savvy. Also, I think that in this event, and I've heard it a lot, we had China, we had sort of Singapore, etc. These sort of the investors and the sponsors, people that are donating, they're coming from more international locations than just sort of perhaps domestically. And so from a payments perspective, which is obviously where I sort of sit, that's actually quite interesting. And so the payment journey that your customers are going through are actually very relevant. And this is something that I think we can help with. So who are Worldpay? And thank you very much for sort of saying we're quite huge. It is quite a sort of a big company. But what we effectively do, we're a technology, data, and payments company. And we specialize in providing e-commerce solutions to domestic and global merchants in the e-commerce space. We're sort of headquartered in London. We have 25 locations around the world. And we've been going for 30 years, but actually 30 years is a bit of a misnomer as well, because it depends on who we're talking to. Actually, technically, we're only 5 years old, because that's when we were bought from Royal Bank of Scotland, but we don't like to mention that too much, as probably some of you are aware. Last year we routed or transacted over 13 billion transactions, which is quite a lot. And we work with a number of interesting companies across multiple verticals, from the digital space and LinkedIn, for example, with airlines, and also in the retail space with sort of companies like Alibaba, as you can sort of see up here. Now, we're a little bit different, I think, to normal payments company. Our uniqueness is that we don't only own the payment piece, the gateway piece. We actually have our own licenses too, which have a number of different benefits, I think, for our customers. And somewhat fortuitously for being here, we actually got our license in Australia this year. So that means that we can work with all of you guys here. Okay. So what am I doing here today? So we conducted some research in the last 12 months around the online payment journey. What I want to do today is to share some of those learnings with you that perhaps can help you on your journey and your e-commerce sort of strategy. Let me just introduce the research very quickly. So first and foremost, we did an audit of some of our top performing merchants around the world. And we did that in 14 countries to get a sort of a good geographical spread. And we asked them, you know, what are the important things that you do to really help, you know, convert those customers from just visiting your website to actually ones that actually sort of, you know, spend money or put money through that site. We thought, hang on a minute, you know, that's only sort of half of the story, because actually you need to go and ask the customers what they want. You know, what's important to them when they're actually using your online presence. And so we did exactly the same, 500 customers around the world in those same 14 countries. So we kind of came up with this online payment journey. It's not necessarily that unique, but it's sort of quite interesting learnings. And I'm going to sort of share a little bit more with you guys today. So the payment journey. It's about the shopping cart and the payment page, right? That's all it's all about. Well, actually, apparently, it's not. There are seven stages that you need to consider, from the home page to the payment page, but also how you kind of wrap yourself around the support elements, you know, with those customers as well. So what did we discover? I'll go into a little bit more granular detail. But firstly, let's start with the home page. Apparently, it's really important to have a security logo on the website, at least to in some countries. I've always been a little bit dubious about that. You know, so Pete, you can just stick anything on your website and so someone believes you. But actually, it is quite important in certain markets. We heard a little bit earlier about China. I mean, these numbers here, sort of 16%, 12%, they sort of seem relatively small, but actually, you know, we just have to remember that there are about 1.4 billion people in China, and there's 1.3 billion people in India. So if they're markets that you're looking at, it's probably statistically relevant to actually consider, you know, maybe putting a security logo on your website to sort of verify who you are. And you'll start to sort of see some of these trends forming here about really making sure that you're building that trust with your customer and the communication and managing that expectation with the customer are all important. Okay, staying on that home page, it's very important to actually make sure that you're putting the payment types that you're actually using on your front page. And if you look at a Chinese retailer, for example, if you've ever been and ever bought anything from a Chinese retailer, and you look right at the bottom, they will have all of their payment types along the bottom. And they're quite experts in this. So you don't actually sort of see that in some other international markets. But you can sort of start to see how actually relevant that is and important that is to do that. And it's more relevant in those countries where you see you know, perhaps more domestic and local payment types that are prevalent in those particular markets. You know, China's a great great example of that. And we talked about a little bit earlier about, so I heard a little bit more about the, you know, sort of looking a little bit more internationally at your at the business. Again, on that sort of subject of trust, it's that sort of localization actually becomes quite important. Now we can all, you know, perhaps sort of translate a website, put it into Mandarin, put it into Japanese, whatever that may be. But actually when it comes down to the actual payment piece, again, handing over your money, it's actually quite relevant to try and transact in that local currency that you're operating in. So as you can see here, there's a 24% dropout if you don't sort of see that that currency that you're looking for. And that's especially relevant because, I mean, if you go and sort of, you know, put your money into this website and all of a sudden you read your credit card a little bit later and it's got an extra fee, there's a cross-border fee or there's a foreign exchange fee and you weren't quite so sure about that being the case, that trust that you're trying to build with your customers is actually starting to be broken. And that's, again, really, really sort of challenging in a faceless transaction. Remember, we're not in front of these people, you know, when we're engaging our customers. Okay, moving to the shopping cart page. Surcharging actually is sort of quite a big thing in Australia, at least it was until the end of last year. But it's not just about credit card surcharging, it's actually sort of surcharges perhaps for shipping, logistics, etc., etc. And it's actually really important to make sure that you're not just sort of chucking those on there or they're hidden, but you're actually sort of putting them on there, explaining to the customers perhaps what these are for. And people are quite, you know, prepared to pay some of these sort of surcharges in certain countries if they know what they're, if they're actually sort of paying. Okay, moving to the payment page. We conducted some more research actually this year called the Global Payments Report. And it's effectively looking at a majority of the key e-commerce markets around the world from today, this year, to 2020. It's pretty self-explanatory, right, to put your payment options when you actually get to your payment page. But what's the real key message here, I think, from my perspective, is to make sure that, you know, you really are cognizant of what payment types are relevant in each market from a geographical perspective. As you can sort of see, we're starting to see a significant growth in e-wallets around the world, and cards are actually, if not growing at a slower rate, almost decreasing in some markets. And a lot of this has been driven by that millennial generation again, who are looking for, you know, flexibility, they're looking for control, they're looking for something that's not cards, it's sort of anti-establishment perhaps in terms of their approach. And I think what's also important to think about here and consider is that what works on a desktop does not necessarily work on a mobile. And I'm assuming, you know, you guys are going to have a mobile as part of your e-commerce strategy is going to be mobile related too. And I'll give you an example of that. I live in Singapore now, and there's a sort of direct debit payment network called Nets, and they have an e-commerce part of that called eNets. And eNets is fine when you're on a desktop. You know, you put your details on and something pops up, and then you go and verify with your bank, and then they verify you, and there's lots of these pop-ups that sort of come up. It's fine, it works. You know, your money comes out of your bank account. But you try doing that on a mobile. I don't know about you, but I've got fat fingers, and trying to put numbers on a mobile device, and then these pop-ups are popping up all over the place. That is a less than favorable payment experience, and, you know, relating back to the whole concept of what I'm trying to talk about today, it's not a good journey. And people will drop out. People hate that. I've dropped out of a payment because I've tried to use that. And so that's something to be very, very, very sort of thoughtful of, again, when you're building your strategy. Okay. So staying with the payment page again, and on that sort of subject of communication and managing that customer expectation as you go through this journey, it's about actually explaining what's going to happen next. Again, this is a faceless transaction. You can't talk to them throughout this process. So it's really important to try and, you know, explain what's happening next. A lot of payment types, the alternative payment types, can be redirect. So you press on it, it takes you somewhere else, and it comes back again. And if your customer doesn't know, and perhaps they don't trust your brand quite as much yet, and they don't know what's happening, and all of a sudden you're going somewhere else, that can actually be very challenging in terms of, again, engaging that customer, building that trust with that customer. 72% of people say this is important. In the example that you can see up here, you know, we've got PayPal. Right? We all know PayPal. It's a significant sort of consumer payment brand. And what they've done really well here, this particular merchant said, right, okay, you've used PayPal. You're going to be redirected to another site. You've got a certain amount of time to go and complete that purchase. And then they're sort of managing that expectation again about, this is how you get back onto the merchant site, which is probably all important, right? Okay, what happens if something goes wrong? And I'm relatively sure that we've all experienced something like this when we've been online, right? You're sort of sitting at your computer and you've made a payment, you're feeling all good about yourself, about what you've bought, donated, whatever that may be, and something goes wrong. You know, perhaps the page just goes sort of empty, or, you know, perhaps a message comes up and goes, sorry, didn't work. And you're sort of looking at this going, okay, well, was it me? Is it something I've done? You know, was it my card? Was there something wrong with my card? Have I paid my credit card bill? Could have happened. Is it the company I'm actually trying to sort of, you know, buy from? Can I trust them? Can I trust this particular merchant? And probably the most important sort of question I'm sure we've all asked is, have they taken my money? And again, this is a faceless transaction. So, you know, this is trust thing coming up again, right? So you can sort of see that some people like it, some people don't. But people will not come back if you break that trust. And especially when you're at that point of actually pressing that button and saying, here's my money, please take it. And that's really, really important, I think, to sort of consider. The data and information does exist. There's a little bit of a plug. But if you've got the right payments partner, actually that information can be shared. So for example, things like, again, if you haven't paid your credit card bill, you know, if you've forgotten to pay it, and you this message comes up and saying, I'm sorry, there are no funds left. At least that's a communication, you know, with that with you, that you can actually sort of manage that expectation about how to sort of how to go through that journey. Okay. Payment confirmation. Now, if something did go wrong, perhaps the screen went blank when you were going through your payment process, but you received an email or a text message, something very simple, like, you know, thanks for your donation, thank you for your payment, whatever that may look like, and this is how much it was for, and this is the currency perhaps it was in. You know, it doesn't take too much to be able to do that. An email address, a text message, even just if something did go right, if it does go right on the site, and it's just a thank you very much for using us, etc., etc. A lot of people do like that, and it becomes very relevant. It's something very simple, but again, it's just building that whole trust through that whole process, from taking that money, going through that journey, and then just telling them, yes, everything's good. And if it does go wrong, and there isn't a confirmation, at least you know that something perhaps has gone wrong, or they haven't taken your money, they can actually contact you, and that sort of communication bridge is still there between you and ultimately your end customer. Okay. So I just want to leave you with a few top tips, a little bit of a summary perhaps of what we've actually sort of just shared with you just now. First and foremost, be loud and proud about the sort of logos, the security logos, the payment logos. Stick them on there. This is good. This, again, it's just managing that customer expectation. The payment piece around, this is what you can accept. If you have to go through all those different processes, to actually sort of get to the payment part, and you realize, I haven't got that card, and you can't make that payment. China's a great example of that. China, we've mentioned China before. China online, I think it's something like 90 to 95% of payments are done through China UnionPay, Alipay, and WeChat Pay, increasingly WeChat Pay. Visa and MasterCard, our traditional sort of credit cards perhaps that we're all aware of, it's got like 3% market share there. Now, of course, they're trying to do something about that, but right now, if you're engaging customers in a market like China, and you haven't got those three payment types, and they're not on your front of your page, then that is definitely, a breakdown in communication, managing that expectation of that end customer. And localization, again, just getting a little bit closer. We talked about this already, getting a little bit closer to your customers, and just sort of managing that currency piece around, yes, I am local, you can trust me, you can give your money to me, I can be contacted. All important, again, in that faceless transaction and building that trust. Surcharging, inform them about that up front. Communication, again, be clear about the steps in your payment process. Again, managing that expectation of what's happening. And things like sort of offering to store customer payment details. All this can be done, right? Tokenization, I don't know how much of this you know, but you can store that, and you can do that very securely. And again, the right payment partner, another plug, can help you to sort of manage that process. But it's all about that customer experience, knowing a customer, building that trust, getting them through that journey. I guess on the sort of the subject of making it sort of easy for a customer, sort of filling those customer details in. Again, that having those credit card details on file can just make that sort of process a lot easier. So making it as simple as possible, and that also goes from a mobile perspective. Those kind of payment types that are more, kind of one-click type experience, where you don't have to go through, as I said before, the fiddly sort of entering of numbers and details. And the sort of, again, that sort of communication around the error messages, which are all important. And reassure those customers about that payment, and I guess the broader subject around this is really to sort of really provide that kind of that love and warm feeling and that support as they're sort of going through that sort of process. A number of merchants that I sort of see and talk to, they actually put a payments expert in their call center to make sure that at all times, to make sure that if a customer does have a bad experience, that they call through, that there's someone on the line that goes, yes, I know what you've experienced, I understand, this is why it's happened, this is how we can resolve it for you, and this is what we're going to do, as opposed to, I have no idea what happened, let me go and call the payment company or the bank or whoever that sort of may be in that sort of process. With Worldpay, by the way, we are the bank as well, and that's the acquiring license piece, so we don't have that sort of challenge, but I'll leave that one with you. But that, again, it's that sort of really, the sum of it all is around communication, it's around managing their expectation, and most importantly, building that online trust from a brand to a person, as opposed to a person to a person, a sort of point of sale transaction that perhaps we're all used to. Okay, I think that's relatively quick as well. I apologize if I've gone too fast. But listen, we have a ton of data and insights. That was a real snapshot of the kind of information we've got on there. Feel free to go to the website. As I said, we've just done this global payments report this year. It looks at all these different countries around the world. It has sort of, what are all the different payment types, in each sort of single country, what the growth variances will be over the next sort of 3 or 4 years. It's just useful and interesting sort of information. Great down the pub when you sort of get down these sort of fantastic statistics. I'm really interesting nowadays. This is it's good for me. Guys, listen, thank you very much. That's it from me. I've got one of my team here, Cecilia. If you have any sort of questions, feel free to come up afterwards. Happy to sort of answer it. As I said, this is an area of interest from our perspective. So willing to share as little as much as you want. Thank you very much.